Now it's go.
Welcome, Facebook Live people, to Boost Biz Ed. We're about to jump into a great presentation. We have Glenn Bott here to speak about solopreneur and how to thrive as an individual. So thrive on your own. So Glenn Bott is a keynote speaker chronicling his miraculous recovery from severe life-threatening injury to reestablish his personal power. Founder of Warrior's Way LLC, he now speaks and coaches with businesses on lateral thinking, problem solving, reinventing yourself, new product development, and success. Glenn helps individuals and businesses focus on important issues and eliminate energy-draining distractions and activities. Standing tall in your truth, realize your value and genius, move toward your personal vision to break through previous self-imposed limitations, epitomizing how we create our lives based upon the stories we tell ourselves. Two words sum up Glenn's life: resilient and authentic. So with rousing applause, let's welcome Glenn Bott to the front of the room.
Good day. Great one. It was a great one. I agree. They're all good. It is my honor to be here to help you learn some skills that can help you survive and thrive as an entrepreneur, as a solopreneur. Because whatever happens, it's all in here. We're in charge of our thoughts. Everything else is out there. And we get to choose our reaction to it. We'll start off. When I say the word Coors, what do you think of?
Beer.
Exactly. Beer. After I graduated from CU as an engineer, that's where I got my first job, Coors. This was back in the 70s, late 70s. And they were extremely innovative. And I did not know that at the time. All of what I learned that helped me survive and thrive, both personally and grow my solopreneur business, was from Coors, that huge international behemoth. But they were extremely entrepreneurial, and that's what I'll share with you today, the skills they taught us. When I say extremely entrepreneurial, they are the inventors of the aluminum can, which is now everywhere. They had an engineering force of 600 people, and it didn't cost them a dime. And the reason it didn't cost them anything was they would patent and license the technology they developed. Of course, they would keep it first, and then they would license it outside, and all that revenue came in, more than paid for the 600 engineers. Brilliant. Jeff Coors was over our particular division. At the time, Bill and Joe were running the place, and Joe's kids were Jeff and Pete. Jeff did the engineering and R&D side, and Pete did the marketing side. Jeff always said, we're a technology company that happens to sell beer. The entire attitude was to find a better way. If anyone in the company, if they had an idea to improve the performance, the lightweight container, talk to us. Put a proposal together, show us what the potential savings are. If it looks viable, let's do it. And so everyone's out there just doing their thing. I was in the R&D department. There were about 10 of us. And we could do anything we wanted. Our guidelines were, our mission was, improve the performance of the packaging line. At the time, Coors could brew a ton of beer. They could ship a ton of beer. Getting the beer in the proper container was always the bottleneck. So they had cans, bottles, and kegs. Quarts, you know, the 12 ounce and all that. And then they started coming out with flavors. That's when it got really fun. We're out there, we're learning this stuff. We learn what you focus on expands. We learn the power of a positive mental attitude before it was popular to have a positive mental attitude. Bill Coors came and gave us a talk one time. And he told us that. He quoted Henry Ford. Henry Ford's famous saying, whether you say you can or can't, either way you're right. Because we were in the R&D department and our job was to lead the effort, he really reinforced, have a positive mental attitude. So your job was to know the end goal, the vision. And then you work out the details as you move forward. And that's what I'll help you with today. We are now in the gig economy, the freedom economy. Turns out, and I just realized this recently, I'm a closet millennial. I say that because I've always had the attitude, get the job done, and then go play. Coors, again, very, very flexible. As long as you got your job done, go out. So there'd be afternoons, I'd have my meetings, dad, do this stuff in the morning. Nothing happened, had some downtime, I'd go take a bicycle ride. Then I'd come back and finish up. He didn't care. As long as you got your job done, as long as you delivered the goods, they don't care. So it was very, very refreshing. So for you, solopreneurs, when you're out there, some tidbits for you. First impressions. We all know the importance of them. What you probably don't understand or fully comprehend is first impressions, yeah, we know they're important, but they're, people get anchored to those first impressions. So it's very important, give some thought ahead of time when you go meet with that person. They've got some expectations. They're not sure what they're going to get out of it. There's some sort of problem they got, and they think you might have a solution. So work on those first impressions. Make them positive. I always suggest greet the person warmly, have a smile, and pay them a heartfelt, authentic compliment. Not just something, you know, off the top of your head. Get to know them a little bit, and then say something authentic. Help them remember that when they met with you, they felt good. A lot of people are running in deficit in today's world. They're not feeling so good. They're busy. They're running busy, but they're not feeling good. So help them out. Help them feel better. They'll remember you. Next one. Get results. They got a problem. They're looking to you for a solution. Remember that. When you're dealing with your customer, what do they want? They want a solution and they want to feel better. If you can help them solve a problem, they're going to feel better. So don't bring them more problems. Don't tell them about how crappy your day's going, your accidents, your car wreck. They don't care. WIIFM, they're thinking, what's in it for me? They want you to help them out. They want you to solve a problem. They want you to make their life better. So be on guard when you're talking to people. Bring them good news and don't tell them about what's going on in your day. Again, also, they got a problem, you got a solution, find a match. You're not going to be a match for everyone. We all got a little different vibe, we have a different way of doing things. You know, that's fine, that's why there's vanilla and chocolate. So go out there and meet people. Tony Hsieh. You guys know who Tony Hsieh is? Founder of Zappos, a billionaire. So Tony's got this concept of bumping into people. Tony's got a vision of making Las Vegas, downtown Las Vegas, Silicon Valley, Midwest. He wants to make it a tech mecca. So he's buying properties, he's redoing hotels, and he's allowing for what he calls collisions. Letting people bump into each other. Because when you bump into each other, like when we did here earlier, you share a little story of that, and you start saying, oh, should we do this? Okay, I need something, I know who to go to. So his entire concept is to maximize collisions. So as you go through your day, maximize your collisions. Give people a reason to feel good. What's your why? Why are you doing what you're doing? That is much more important today than it's probably ever been up to this point. Everyone wants to know, why are you doing this? Because there's a lot of people out there that are probably in your niche. They want to know, why should I do business with you? In the real estate world, it's all location, location, location. In the small business world, in the solopreneur world particularly, it's relationships, relationships, relationships. Build and nurture your relationships. And a relationship isn't someone that's on your contact list that you send out a newsletter to. It's those people that they want to talk to when they got a problem. They want a solution. They want to feel better. That's a relationship. So work on building the relationships. What you focus on expands. I'm a big believer with training in positive thinking. The average person has 50,000 to 70,000 thoughts per day. recent study showed that between 80 and 98% of those thoughts are negative or diminishing. We got a lot of people out there telling a crappy story, telling a story that's preventing them from living the life they are capable of. And why? Because they're just telling themselves a story. You tell it enough, you start believing it. So start telling a new story. That's what I'm about, telling a new story. A place to start. Think about your business, your soul from your business. What one word would you use to sum it up? For example, my word was empowerment. I like to help people realize their power, because once they realize their power and they understand they can do this, they kind of get a little swagger. They go, hey, I got this. And that is the secret to success. And this one word will evolve over time. And that's fine. It's a process. So take your one word, play with it, scratch out that one, the next day you come back, it might be the same word, it might be different. Give it some time, but then ultimately you'll get to the point where, yeah, that's the word. So take that word, and now grow it. Start with that word as the foundation. Write your elevator pitch, a few sentences that describes who you are, what you do, and why you're doing it. And a good elevator pitch is compelling. It gets people to say, ooh, I want to learn more. It's memorable. Hi, I'm Sarah, I'm an accountant. It's not a compelling elevator pitch. There are a lot of those out there. Give them a reason to establish a connection with you. So craft it. Once you have your elevator pitch, through collisions and bumping into people, you'll start attracting business. Like-minded clients looking for solutions that you offer. And then grow that. Take your customers to heart. Was taught many great things, of course. What you focus on expands. Again, beware of that. A few simple words that you'll find, when you focus on the positive stuff, you'll get more of that. If you focus on the negative stuff, you get more of that. Train yourself to observe your thoughts. Or as I learned, stop. Stop yourself to see, where is my line of thinking going? Does it take me to a positive place, or is it taking me to a negative place? If you find out when you check in, you're doing that with those 50 to 70,000 thoughts a day, oh, I don't like where this is going, stop and create a new thought and replace it. And start repeating that many times a day until it becomes automatic. And it will become part of your story, and then your life will start improving. So we learned, commitments are carved in stone. That was our group. And we were an R&D group. No one reported directly to us. There were 10 of us. And our job was to, like I said, improve the performance of the packaging lines. Either through equipment, new methodologies, or new processes. We had some great bosses back then. It became our group's little saying. Commitments are carved in stone. One year for Christmas, our boss got us all a stone. The word commitment's carved in. We put it on our desk. And they were, like I said, Coors was way ahead of their time. They were brilliant. By giving us that, it does a lot of things. It allows us, when we walk in, we see it, we mentally go, commitments are carved in stone. That's who we are, that's what we do. So your efficiency, your story becomes more prevalent, more automatic. They were also brilliant because then when people come and sit down with us, vendors or other people from around the company, they see that and they go, what's that? What's that about? So again, it gave us another opportunity to say, commitments are carved in stone. This is what we do. This is how it works. Ah, here we go. Got it. It helped us become memorable and very, very persuasive because we did what we said we would do. By default, if you do what you say you will do, you will stand above the crowd because most, I'm pulling a number out of an orifice, don't, 98%, I'm guessing, have no clue. They just talk whatever. People have asked me, okay, Glenn, what is a commitment? How's that different than a promise? I had to give some thought to that. Because we have been steeped in it for so long, it was automatic for us. I came up with this analogy. When we were little kids, you're playing, you're in the pool, or you're in a watering hole, in a ditch, whatever, and your friends, and someone's, you know, goofing around, you dive in, and they grab your ankle, and they're holding you down. And at first it's kind of fun, you know, you're like, oh, you goof, you know, let me go. But they don't let you go. You're looking up, and you see in the surface, and you know, oxygen's up there, you're starting to run out of it. At that point, every fiber of your being is committed to reaching the surface and taking a breath of air. You're not thinking about what you're going to watch TV that night, your drive home, or your homework. All you are thinking about is the surface. Excuse me, getting a breath of air. That is a commitment. When you have that sort of focus and energy, you are unstoppable. Another example I give about having a vision, having an end goal in mind. If I said, okay, we're going to go here, we go out, we're going to walk north to Fort Collins. If you all chose to take that on, you said, yeah, I commit to doing that, would you plan every step you took? Yes or no?
No.
Why? Because it's ludicrous. It's inefficient. You have no idea what's ahead of you. All you know is where you are going. And as you walk forward, you may encounter an obstacle, a hole, a ditch. So you move to the side. Oh, I can move forward here. And you walk forward. That is how you get things done. You be flexible, you focus on your vision, you have committed to accomplishing your goal, and day to day, you adjust based on what's happening. Your vision. You're a solopreneur. Why are you doing what you're doing? Take a moment and ask yourself that. Is it to make money? If it's just to make money, you can do that in the corporate world. I'm assuming you left the corporate world for a reason, either voluntarily or involuntarily. Either way, you decide not to go back, so you're doing something on your own. What's important to you? What makes your heart sing? As I told you, when I was a course, I can honestly and enthusiastically say, I have never worked a day in my life. I always had a blast. When I went into Coors, it was always fun because I didn't know exactly what the day was going to be like. The guy on the right there, pieces of the puzzle coming together. That's how I did my project. I viewed my projects as a large, dynamic puzzle. I never knew, is the decision going to come by on time? Are the parts going to show up on time? Am I going to get the approval to move the equipment? Didn't know. It was out of my control. But I did not worry about it because it's a waste of time and energy. Again, positive mental attitude, as we were taught. Focus on what you can control. If you can't control it, let it go. I notice a lot of people these days spend a lot of time and energy diminishing their health and their energy, focusing on things they can't control. My suggestion to you would be quit. Also, you're doing what you're doing because it's a calling in your heart, a something about it you enjoy. Bring your funding. Bring your gift. Share what you've got. Be the best version of you you know how to be. Knowing that in the next moment, it'll be different. But just be authentic and be yourself. We were also taught at Coors, like I said, a great place, corporate America, taught me a lot about being a solopreneur. Be authentic, be you. There's a lot of people out there. We all know those people that aren't authentic. And what's the feeling you get from them?
Slimy.
Okay, that's good. You don't trust them. We were, again, through my teachings of Coors, a lot of people, here's what they say, and here's what they do, and they don't match. People with power and integrity, here's what they say, and here's what they do, and they line up. That's how your power and influence grow. That's how we became so effective and respected and influential at Coors. I talked earlier about commitments. The highest commitment you can make is a commitment to yourself. Be impeccable with your word. Say, hey, I love and respect myself enough that I am not going to BS myself. If I say something, I'm doing it. And so it also requires you, as you go through this process, to become more aware and think consciously of how I want to react to this. Do I want to commit myself, my time, my efforts to doing this or not? It's a simple equation, yes or no. I suggest doing that. Stop triggering your energy around on many things, most of which aren't effective and are part of the story you're telling yourself to keep busy. Little lifeguard tower with the camera. That's to illustrate that we are always being watched. If we watch people, they're watching us. And as Joyce said, those that here's what they say, here's what they do, we think slimy or some stronger words. We don't trust and respect them. When you're authentic, you are being yourself 100% of the time. You are doing what you say you'll do when you say you'll do it. When you do that, when you're impeccable, like I said, you will stand out in the crowd. People will remember you. Your influence will grow. You'll be welcome wherever you go. How many out there blame? I got some nod, a little shy hand. I got a feeling most, at some point, blame. Another thing I was taught, do not blame. When you blame, you are a victim. Assume 100% responsibility for everything that occurs in your life, good or bad. You're in charge of it. And when you're in charge of it, you can change your mind. If you're a victim, can't do that. You're always in reaction to whatever's happening around you. So start assuming 100% responsibility. No matter what happens, say, okay, I'm in charge of it. I'll take care of that. I'm responsible for that. A story I like to tell. And I don't remember the chain. There's a hotel chain that used Garfield as their mascot. I don't really know what the chain was. This is a few years ago. Anyway, Garfield is a mascot. The gentleman comes in late one night, he gets a room upstairs, and it's by an elevator. And the elevator's running up and down, he can't sleep too good, gets up in the morning, and there's no hot water. He is not a happy camper. He goes down, and he starts complaining to the front desk. You guys gotta be kidding me. I pay good money here, you know, I get my room with elevator, I can't sleep, and then I don't have hot water. The manager happened to be behind the counter. And he came back. And he said, sorry, sir. He jumped right into the middle of the firestorm, which I suggest you do. Because whenever there's a volatile situation, that is an excellent opportunity to expand your awareness, your power, and help people feel better and help them remember you. This guy is always irate. He's complaining, getting louder. The manager comes out there and goes, "No, I'm sorry, here, what happened?" And so he tells him the story. The manager says, "You know, I'm sorry, I didn't realize the elevator was that noisy. And our sincerest apologies on no hot water. What can we do to compensate you?" And the manager had the authority to give him two or three nights free stay, you know, whatever it took. All the gentleman wanted was a stuffed Garfield to take home to his kid. Moral of the story, go to the center of the storm, find a solution, and ask the customer, what's it going to take to get us back on an even keel to make you happy? Because you will oftentimes be surprised at what they want. He just wanted the little stuffed Garfield to take home for his kid. He's not looking for two or three nights. He didn't care because he's not paying for that. He's on a corporate account. He wants a little Garfield. Failure. Many of us, I don't know, in my world, we're brought up, failure is not a good thing. In reality, failure is an excellent thing. The Western world, I think we were sold a bill of goods, at least my generation, when we were growing up. Don't fail. You know, it means you're not paying attention, you're not focused, plenty of reasons. Failure is excellent because you now found something else that didn't work. To quote Thomas Edison, he had the vision, the light bulb. He didn't know how to make it work, he just knew it could work. And so, as the story goes, he went through 10,000 different items to try out to be the filament for the light bulb. One would fail. He would go, I'm that much closer to success. And I found something else that doesn't work. Develop that mindset. Something doesn't happen the way you want it to, ask yourself, what can I learn from this? How can this make me better? What's another approach? Now we're into the good stuff. Lateral thinking. Went to a lot of workshops, highly trained in this. I love it. Lateral thinking is a fancy way of saying creativity. Finding new ways to connect the dots. Because there are almost infinite solutions to any problem you've got. But if you've got a narrow-minded focus, all you can see are those narrow-minded possible solutions. If you broaden that, you start seeing other possible solutions. Again, we were trained. Lateral thinking. We always made a game out of it. How is that tripod like that chair? You can start putting some notes together. How is that clock in the back like this computer? Put some things together. How is my product, how would it be used if someone only had one hand? It forces you to think differently. An excellent example of lateral thinking. A school teacher, middle school teacher, he's got an unruly class. So he gives them an assignment. I want you to add all the numbers between 1 and 100 and then give me the answer. He figures that'll take him a while, keep him quiet. So most of the kids are out there 1 plus 2 plus 3, and they're doing, you know, as most of us would do. He notices in the back of the room, some little kids just out there kind of spacing out. He sees his eyes moving back and forth. You can tell him, he's doing some thinking. All of a sudden, the kid sits up, puts his paper, writes for a little bit, raises his hand. I got the answer. The teacher's like, "You gotta be kidding me. It's only been like 30 seconds. He goes back there and talks to him. Sure enough, he had the answer. What he realized, while most of the kids are doing 1 plus 2 plus 3, he was looking at the big picture. He saw that 100 plus 1 is 101. 99 plus 2 is 101. 98 plus 3 is 101. Hello? The light went off. So what's 50 times 101? 50-50. That was the correct answer. That is an excellent example, and I'm sure you'll remember, of lateral thinking. That's the benefit of it. Incredible. I also speak on business Aikido. Aikido is the Eastern philosophy of accepting anything that comes your way and redirecting the energy to your benefit. Very skilled at that. I suggest to you begin developing that attitude. And it's really an attitude. Something happens. How can I use this to my benefit? What are some other ways I can turn this and use it to help me, to help my business grow and thrive? Just another example. There are many ways to find a solution. Ask yourself powerful questions. Ask different questions. How would this look underwater? What if everyone was blind? How could my product help them? Anything. And get skilled at doing it. And if you're doing it with a group of people, don't judge. We used to have monthly brainstorming sessions. You would sign up in the queue to get some ideas, even for projects that you kind of ran into a wall. We learned that by not judging, you just go around the room, someone may have a goofy idea, it triggers another goofy idea, you're mentally judging, you're not saying anything, you go, goofy, goofy. Third person goes, and they come up with a great idea. And you go, whoa. So brainstorming is about the process, not the individual ideas. So have the courage, get a few friends, read different magazines from different industries, and ask yourself, how can I use that in my industry? How can that benefit my business? Yoda, my man. As I told you, our little group, humans are carved in stone. We also had training on the power of words. The trainer comes in. He's up there and he says, can I have a volunteer, please? So I'll ask, can I have a volunteer, please? Oh, no, no, okay. Okay, great. Almost bit. Oh. I'm sorry, Renee.
Renee,
I'm glad. Would you try to pick up that pen, please?
I've already gone through this, though.
Okay. Okay. Thank you. Mm-hmm. The point being, she picked up the pen. You know, what am I doing right now? Well, I'm thinking about trying to pick up that pen. What are you doing? Oh, I'm trying to pick up the pen. Try
does nothing.
Begin speaking with powerful words. Words like try, you have no commitment. You don't know what is going to happen. So if you go to someone and you say, hey, here's what I need. I need this. They go, well, I'll try to get it to you. Good luck. It may happen, it may not. You don't have a clue. When you make a commitment, two things are required. You agree with the other person, what is the deliverable? What is it I am going to deliver to you? And then what's the due date? Once you have those two things, you've got a commitment. It is then your responsibility to deliver to that person on or before that due date. If something changes outside your control, it's your responsibility to get back to that person and renegotiate. Words have incredible power. In emails, think of your emails. They're out there forever. So be very careful when you write an email. If you're all hot and bothered, fine, write it out, vent a little bit, don't send. I always suggest sleep on it, come back the next day, read it. You might feel better. You might say, yeah, a little brash here and there. And also get down to the essence. What is it you want to communicate to the other person? Communicate that and stop. We all get a lot of emails. We all get a lot of texts. Keep it simple. Keep it short. Keep it focused. The more focus you can keep it, the less chance there is of confusion and possible issues down the road. Try, kind of, sort of, maybe, look into. Those are what I call weaning words. They have no power. If someone uses those words, it's your responsibility to talk to them and get a commitment. Someone says, I'll get back to you. When? 5 minutes? 5 days? 5 years? You don't know. But you're on the other end. You're on the receiving end. You want to make sure things are moving forward effectively. Get a carbon stone. Get a commitment. Make sure that everyone's on the same page. So what's your story? My story. I left Coors. Had my own product development business. Riding bikes one night. Got struck by an SUV head on. Bam! Was in a coma for 10 days. Severe brain injury. And they told my wife, very low odds, he will ever be able to be alone again. He will most likely need 24/7 daycare. My wife walked over to me later on. She said, don't listen to them. She also knew, she worked at Coors too, she knew the power of our story. She knew that by keeping a positive mental attitude and telling a story over and over, you can heal. Again, we're incredibly powerful. Along the same lines of that story, so as my brain starts coming back online, I'm at Craig Rehab now, I'm out of my coma, months in Craig Rehab, and I'm coming out from a doctor meeting, and he's giving us the news. And he says, your improvement has plateaued. Nice medical way of saying, you know, we're not seeing stuff happen. It won't go down, brain injuries don't work that way, but it's not going up anymore. It may continue, it may not be as steep anymore. We can't say, let's make the best of it. And my brain was coming back online at this time. So I'm walking out of the meeting, my wife, and we're walking back to the room. And I'm like, I'm against the wall because my balance wasn't real good. We walk along and I stop. I turn to her and I say, I'm not doing this. I'm not doing what? I said, I am not going through life brain injury. I'm going to fully recover. That was my vision. That was my commitment. That was my what. Don't get tied up in the how. Focus on the what. What are you going to do? So that is what the story I began telling myself. I'm going to fully recover. My life is going to work. I'm going to get back having fun, because prior to that, my wife and I were having a blast. I didn't want to miss that anymore. So that was my goal. Get back, have fun, fully recover. So again, ask yourself throughout the day, check in. What is your story? What's going on in your head? Are you clipping your own wings in the process of telling your story? Or is it helping you soar and thrive? And that's it.
Thank you, Glenn. You're a few minutes early, so let's open up for questions. So, Facebook Livers, you can ask questions, and we can hopefully get those live. But if anyone in the room has questions, Glenn's here. We got a few minutes, so
if jump I don't in. Have an answer, I'll make it up.
Anybody? Bueller? Bueller? Joyce has one there.
I just actually comment. Isn't Be Impeccable With Your Word one of the four agreements from the book Four Agreements?
It is. Don Miguel
I
Ruiz.
I want to read that again. What?
It's a good one. Don Miguel Ruiz.
Yeah, it's an incredible book.
Yeah.
People haven't read it. Read it again.
Yeah, exactly. It's a good one.
Thank you for that. I just thought you rang the bell.
All right, any other questions?
Any questions?
Can we say comment? Awesome.
Comments work too?
All right. So again, leaving here, what I would suggest is, for the one theme, come up with your one word. What is it you are about? That will help you focus in on how you're going to live your life and where you're going to go from there. It becomes your center, your foundation, and then expand from that.
Actually, I do have a question. Is there a place that we can get the commitment stone?
Get
stone that says commitment.
You know, can you hold that question for just a second?
Okay.
Yeah.
Glenn, now that we're done, how do we interact with you going forward? How do we reinforce our commitment?
Well, gosh.
All that stuff.
I coach and speak. My why, what I do, I like helping people realize their power. And I said, when I got to the brain injury, came back, my heart opened, and I realized I was given some great tools, and they work for anyone. So I just like to help people realize their power through different. To your question, I've been asked that before. Afterwards, if you want to interact with me, I typically do 30 minutes, we'll have coffee somewhere, see if we're fit, see if what you're after is what I can help you with. If it is, great. If not, you know, that's fine. We can get to have some coffee. I also, after this event here, I've got some stones because I've been asked before, so I had some made. So I got some commitment stones.
That's smart.
They're 10 bucks. So cool. Oh, there is one thing. Hello. I'm getting... Got a couple books out there.
There you go.
Secrets to Reduce Your Medical Debt. After you go through something like that, you find out that maybe your finances weren't quite as robust as you thought.
Yeah.
We also found out, again, reality is plastic. You can negotiate anything. So from our experience, and my wife's the one that did a lot of this because I just couldn't even think that much then, we negotiated some incredible medical debt down. So we got a book out there on how to do that, what to say, who to talk to, et cetera, et cetera. Luke's life lessons. We like dogs. Luke's our new golden retriever pup. Luke's now 4, and Luke's been an excellent teacher. So we put a book together, Luke's Life Lessons. It's a positive kind of a child book, just simple little lessons, be impeccable, that sort of thing. Again, it's on Amazon. Any other questions? Thank you. Appreciate you spending the time today. And I sincerely hope you got some good stuff you can take away and use in your business.
All right, well, one more round of applause. All right, we want to make sure we thank all of our allies. So, Linda, how can we help you with whatever it is that you're going to do next?
I don't know what I'm going to do next, so I'm happy to just have a chat and learn about it.
All right, so if you want to buy her coffee and help her figure out what's next, that's how you interact with Linda. Zoe, how do we interact with you?
To interact with me, Paul, you can give me a call on my phone, shoot me an email, let's get together and have a coffee consultation. I'm really excited about helping people who are tired pulling their hair out with their digital marketing efforts, and I very much love helping people succeed. So, thank you.
All right, our DaVinci girls are not here, so to interact with DaVinci, because they let us use this space, they have all kinds of cool events. There was a cool Bitcoin one last week that I wasn't able to make, but I heard amazing things.
It was awesome.
Yeah, that's what I heard.
Yeah.
Rub it in. But get on their schedule and check out a lot of the cool stuff that they do here. Very futuristic stuff. They have events coming up that I'll have you talk about in just a minute when we get to that part. And then that's Caitlin, Jennifer, and Mikhail, who are not here in the room right now. And then Laura Pensitencio is our social media ally. So if you need to, you know, get your stuff online, she does all that Facebook, Twittering, media, Insta, chats, all that stuff to make sure that you do well there. And then, of course, Drew, our founder, put this together, but he also kind of does some pretty good websites occasionally. So if you need some work done there, reach out to him. And for me, my one word is choices. I give people choices. So if you want more choices with your finances on making more, keeping more, whatever, I'm happy to go have coffee with you and figure out if what I do could give you those choices. So. With that, we're going to go around the room. This is the one breath exercise. So, in one breath, what'd you get out of it? What's the one action you're going to take? And I kind of want to add into the either, what is the problem and solution, or what is your one word? So that might be your feedback for Glenn as well. So, we will start in the front of the room, right here.
Cool.
So, and you can address the camera too, because they're still live and they will have other feedback as well. So Zoe should be walking around with that.
Stand up,
turn around, smile.
My one word is lighter. And I think what I got from this talk is that taking that and incorporating that into the work. I do that with people. I help them to lighten up, but I never really quite made that real strong connection that you helped me to do. So it kind of has breathed a fresh air into my whole purpose and what I want to do and how I want to help people.
Cool.
So simple, but very powerful. Thank you.
All right, what's your one word and feedback?
Mitch Creighton here. My one word, concierge. Help you guide through, give you context to the massive data. Thank you very much. It was very clarifying. And those of you that definitely are thinking about a vacation, instead of making excuses, make an appointment this evening.
All right, Joyce.
Oh, okay. Well, in January, I do a stone at church in our ceremony. We have it was light. And I was thinking that, okay, but light isn't quite exactly enough. So it's in light tone, which I thought was way cool, that because light is right there in the middle, and as I help to enlighten people around social media. So thank you. That was cool for me a lot. And I'm going to reach out to 5 people who and nurture my relationships with them better.
Cool.
My word at the moment is inkyo, because accepting the things that are coming your way and channeling it with energy. However, I can. So.
Cool.
Mm.
Sarah?
Yes, mine is community. Coming together of things and the power of positive, how we make a positive impact for our legacy. Well done. Thank you.
Mm-hmm.
My word is voice, so just helping my clients connect at a deeper level with their vision, with their why they're doing what they're doing, able to articulate that to their potential clients so that their story is getting to the right people.
Cool.
My word is clarity, so I could clearly understand what people are looking for and help find that solution.
My word is positivity, and I'm just staying the course and staying positive and authentic.
One word's impossible. So I'm going to say today my word, the way I feel today, it's fun.
Yeah.
And the one thing I'm going to do is I am about to end a huge position and start freedom.
Yay!
And I'm going to get 5 people together to help me brainstorm all the ideas I have flying around, and maybe we can funnel them into something more concrete.
Stuck in a corner now because this is Linda and she also stole my word fun.
Woo!
Nice. I'm going to have to do more thinking. Thank you for your
talk. My one word is exceptional. Having exceptional images of yourself, exceptional images of your business to want your customers to come see you and be part of that. And thank you, Glenn. I got a great one. It's good.
Thank you. My one phrase that I took away from all this is take failure as feedback. I'm really going to meditate on that and really incorporate that and turn that into a positive.
And Michelle Wilson, and I resonated with a lot of what you said. Great stuff. I love it. And my takeaway is I'm going to think some more on the words. Even before you said it, I was thinking empowerment, but also breakthrough. It really helped my clients break through whatever is them stuck, whether it's big things like trauma or just normal limiting belief kind of thing. So just going to have fun because I see how that word in your marketing can really be helpful.
Opening your own wings is not a word, but it's one idea. And that's giving me something to chew on.
Cool.
Carol, thank you.
My word is fun as well. And as I heard you mutter, there's enough to go around for everybody. So have fun and still get results.
All right. Well, thank you, everybody. Facebook Livers, we're glad you were with us. We're going to have you sign off now. So we'll see you next week. Yes, next week. So upcoming events, we have Russ speak in Vision.